On behalf of the Washington National Cathedral, I welcome you this evening to this service of prayers for the people of Japan, 1 month after the devastating earthquake and tsunami. This evening we gather just at the close of the Cherry Blossom Festival to join hands and hearts with the people who have endured a terrible and continuing tragedy. We've seen on our screens the wreckage and rubble from the devastation. We've gazed in dismay as a brave and resolute people have made their way through the chaos and destruction. And we have watched with admiration the remarkable courage, harmony, and mutual respect of the Japanese people. Tonight we come together in unity of spirit to offer our compassion and prayers for our friends in the land of the rising sun. We stand with them simply by being here, extending our care from afar and keeping vigil for this hour as our fellow human beings labor at the tasks of rebuilding. We pray for them that they may experience God's strength and guidance. During this service, there will be an opportunity to light a candle, and those who would like to light a candle as an expression of prayer may look to members of our staff around them who will guide them to some of the candles in this cathedral where you may light one. And there will be an offering collected later. We will give of our resources as we can for the relief efforts in Japan. Our donation is a tangible expression of our turning prayer into action. Your service cards will have details if you choose to write a check, but you may simply make it out to ERD for the Episcopal Relief and Development Organization. I'd like to extend a special welcome this evening to the Ambassador of Japan to the United States, His Excellency Ichiro Fujisaki, and to all the members of the Japanese community who have gathered here this evening. A special welcome as well to Senator Daniel Inouye from the state of Hawaii, who has joined us as well. And we're grateful to have here, representing the United States government, Kurt M. Campbell, Assistant Secretary of State. And finally, I'd like to express our special welcome to our interfaith friends who have so graciously come to be with us and join in the prayers of the evening. A great spirit of compassion has brought us together tonight. Now, let us pray. We gather this night in your presence, O great Creator, the source of all light and life, to offer our prayers for the people of Japan. The unsettling movement of earth and sea has brought destruction and death, and the people of the world weep in distress. Gracious God, behold with us the land of the rising sun, and be present to her people throughout this great tragedy. Give them strength and hope to face their suffering and bear their grief. Mercifully deliver them from helplessness, and give them confidence to face the present time, knowing that they are not alone in danger and uncertainty. Amen.
We learn to love a place, not just through meeting its people, or its culture, or its landscape, but for me, it's through its poems. When my daughters were first born, my dear friend, before he became Ambassador Fujisaki, he and his wife gave us a lovely book that we have kept in our family for years. It is called Grass Sandals, It is the story of the travels of Basho. Grass Sandals is the story of Basho, who is probably the most beloved poet in the history of Japan, and his journeys on foot around his homeland are celebrated in Japan and around the world. Some of his most lovely poems come from the areas of Japan that have been besieged by the tragedy over the course of the last month. His poems are stories of simplicity and observations. They give glimpses of the ancient culture of Japan, as well as a sense of what it is to be a poet, as the people and experiences that Basho enjoys find their way into his very unique poetry called haiku. Basho's sensitivity to the shapes and forms of nature are celebrated, and they are particularly celebrated in his poems about the seaside, the area that was struck a month ago. And I thought I would just read two of those for you tonight. A tiny pink crab tickling me climbs up my leg from glistening sea. Let's peel cucumbers, pick up fallen red apples for our small supper. Let us never forget the horrible tragedy that has befallen the nation of Japan, our dear friend and ally. But let us not have it end there. Let us commit ourselves as we leave tonight to do everything possible to rebuild Japan and help it find its wonderful peace and serenity that have inspired all of us over these many years.
Unbeaten by rain, unbeaten by wind, unbowed by the snow and the summer heat, strong in body, free from greed, without any anger, always serene, with a handful of brown rice a day, miso and a small amount of vegetables suffice. Whatever happens, consider yourself last. Always put others first. Understand from your observation and experience. Never lose sight of these things. In the shadows of the pine groves in the fields, live modestly under a thatched roof. In the east, if there is a sick child, go there and take care of him. In the west, if there is an exhausted mother, go there and relieve her of her burden. In the south, if there is a man near death, go there and comfort him. Tell him, don't be afraid. In the north, if there is an argument and a legal dispute, go there and persuade them it's not worth it. In a drought, shed tears. In a cold summer, carry on, even with a sense of loss. Being called a fool, being neither praised nor a burden.
My head comes from my それ人間の不祥なる相をつらつら感ずるにおおよそ儚きものはこの世の始終幻のごとくなる一語なりされば未だ漫才の人参の受けたりということを聞かず一生過ぎやすし今に至って誰か百年の業態を保つべきや我や先人や先今日とも知らず明日とも知らず遅れ先立つ人は元の雫末の露よりもしげしと言えりさればあしたには光眼あってゆうべには白骨となれる身なりすでに無常の風来たり濡ればすなわち二つの眼たちまちに通し一つの息長く耐え濡れば光眼虚しく返じて通りの装いを失い濡る時は六神眷属集まって嘆き悲しめどもさらにその甲斐あるべからずさてしもあるべきことならねばとて野外に送って弱の煙となし果てぬればただ白骨の溝を残れり哀れというもなかなか愚かなりされば人間の儚きことは老少不上の境なれば誰の人も早く御所の一大事を心にかけて阿弥陀仏と深く頼み参らせて念仏もすべきものなり花かしこアナカシコ
In silently contemplating the transient nature of human existence, nothing is more fragile and fleeting in this world than the life of man. Thus we have not heard of human life lasting for 1,000 years. Life passes swiftly and few among men can maintain their form for even 100 years. Whether I go before others or others go before me, whether it be today or tomorrow, who is to know? Those who depart before us are as countless as the drops of dew. Though in the morning we may have radiant health, in the evening we may return to white ashes. When the winds of impermanence blow, our eyes are closed forever. And when the last breath leaves us, our face loses its color. Though loved ones may gather and lament, everything is to no avail. The body is then sent into an open field and vanishes from this world with the smoke of cremation, leaving only the white ashes. Nothing is more real than this truth of life. The fragile nature of human existence underlies both the young and old. Therefore, we turn to the teachings of the Buddha Dharma and awaken to the essence of life. By so understanding the meaning of death, we come to appreciate the meaning of this life, which is to be treasured. because it is unrepeatable. By virtue of true compassion, let us realize the unexcelled value of this existence, and let us live together with gratitude in our heart.
Senator, Secretaries, Admiral, ladies and gentlemen, never has mankind experienced three tragedies together: earthquake, tsunami, and nuclear accident. Never have we expected that this would occur to us, and never have we thought that we would deserve such a severe trial. But that is happening, and we are going through it. Nearly 27,000 people have either lost their lives or are still missing. But we should not be distracted only by the huge number, because each life is important and significant. 2 weeks ago, I met the family of a young American lady, English language teacher, who lost their life in tsunami. Taylor Anderson wanted to be a bridge between Japan and America, United States, since her childhood. She became one, and she'll be long remembered as such. Her life was too short, but she accomplished her dream. Her parents is here today. Thank you very much. 1 month after 3/11, we are still struggling. Search and rescue, providing basic human needs, trying to control nuclear reactor, and reconstruction. These are done in extremely difficult condition. For example, aftershocks. One yesterday was even bigger in magnitude than one in Haiti last year. Thus, way ahead is rough, steep, and long. But we are encouraged by some things. First, resilience and civility of the Japanese people. As you have seen, in most difficult condition, people are helping each other. This is the true strength of our people, and I'm proud of that. Secondly, we are supported by people around the world, especially American people. Your rescue team, your forces, your government officials, your experts, there in Japan and here, working day and night with us, as if the disaster is their own. We are so grateful for this. And American people, NGOs, companies, are extending their goodwill and massive contributions. Children around the country have made 1,000 cranes cards and sent to us. So adorable, so soothing and encouraging. And my thanks go to National Cathedral, Very Reverend Lloyd, and all the priests here. Lastly, we are encouraged because we are able to have conviction and hope. Because of the resilience of Japanese and because the solidarity shown by Americans and other people, we are convinced and we can hope that Japan will come back. No, not only come back, but come back even stronger, as President Obama and Prime Minister Khan has stated. So sun will rise. But thank you very much for standing with us in such a difficult moment, most difficult moment for our country, for our people. All the Japanese will long remember this. We will never forget it. From the bottom of my heart, I will say, arigatou gozaimasu. Thank you very much.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord.
for the Lord will not reject forever. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone.
In the name of God, who gives life, strength, guidance, and peace. Japan's pain touches every heart, mind, and soul of this world. And there are many responses at every level of life. Many came from throughout that nation and around the world to rescue, others to provide relief, and soon they will come to rebuild. The responses have been economic, diplomatic, and scientific. The Japanese people themselves have been both stoic and heroic, an example to us all. This tableau of pain and response, of need and care, of grief and comfort, is part of the human story and well worth the attention that we and history give to it. But we have a particular slice of that story before us this evening. We gather here in a house of faith. I stand before you as a man of faith. So it is faith's perspective that I ask you to consider with me for a few moments. The shock of the earthquake, the tsunami, the nuclear accident, with their attending destruction and suffering, almost require that we look up and wonder about the larger context in which we live. In other words, they almost force us to look into the realm of faith. This kind of tragedy raises questions about life and meaning in ways that our routines rarely do. One wants to look into the face of God and ask hard questions. The first one that comes to mind is simply, why? Why? Why do the innocent suffer at the hands of inert tectonic plates and normally placid oceans? Why do these things happen? What necessity is met by them? And when we look up with the eyes of faith and demand that God tell us, the answer inevitably is silence. Silence, for neither the universe nor its mysteries will fit between our ears. Human understanding can reach only so far, and the answer to why is beyond us. We can no more profitably question the reason for tragedy than we can profitably question the reason for love or beauty or tranquility. There is no answer to why. Stumped but not rebuffed, faithful people turn to the other question, how? And that question carries an accusatory tone. How could a loving God, how could even a mildly interested God allow this sort of thing? Could God even have made it happen? Does not love take care of its own? And again, the response is silence. As the reading from Lamentations reminded us, God does not willingly afflict or grieve us, but by the same token, a relationship with God is not a plan of protection. We are, in fact, fragile people who live in a dangerous world. And God's love for us does not change that reality. Every faith story includes the fact of our vulnerability and the reality of the world's dangers. If my Christian tradition were about protecting us from harm, I doubt very much that we would have chosen the cross as our primary symbol. It's a symbol of suffering and death. No, faith is not about protection from danger and harm. So then, if faith neither explains nor protects, what does it do? What does it offer? What does faith bring to the myriad of questions about suffering in general and this particular suffering? Well, there are as many answers to that question as there are reasons we remain faithful, but there are two that are consistent across many faith traditions. And those two are this: strength and guidance. Strength and guidance. In honesty, most of us would admit that we really don't want strength and guidance from our God. What I really want is a set of circumstances where neither one is necessary. What we really want is a world that is so simple that our strength is adequate to its tasks. What I'd really like to have is a clear enough understanding of life so that I know what to do and where to go without the need of guidance. But alas, reality conspires against those hopes, and we must rely on God's strength and God's guidance to live fully and honestly. We rely on God's strength to be joyful and hopeful, even while we remain fragile and the world remains dangerous. It takes a very particular kind of strength of spirit to acknowledge that nothing can be called permanent if it is built on something that is impermanent. It takes a particular kind of strength of spirit to apply the wisdom of Archbishop Williams when he said that the economy is a wholly owned subsidiary of the environment. It takes a particular kind of strength of spirit to see, even in the mind-numbing calculation of death tolls, that every life is precious. As the ambassador said this evening, precious beyond the telling. We need God's unique strength to hold in check the degree to which we are part of the world's danger and a threat to the fragility of others. And we do need God's guidance. We need God's guidance to see and to live into the deeper truths of life as we join in the multiple tasks of grieving and rebuilding. We need God's guidance in order to work through the maze of grief, to finally come to the kind of truth that Anne Morrow Lindbergh found after the death of her child when she wrote these words: "I do not believe that sheer suffering teaches," she wrote. "If suffering alone taught, all the world would be wise, since everyone suffers. To suffering must be added mourning, understanding, patience, love, openness, and the willingness to remain vulnerable. That truth is hard to find on our own. And in the myriad tasks of rebuilding, we need God's firm hand to hold us to the truth that Reinhold Niebuhr pointed to when he wrote these words: "Nothing worth doing can be achieved in our lifetime. Therefore, we must be saved by hope. Nothing which is true or beautiful or good makes complete sense in any immediate context of history. Therefore, we must be saved by faith. Nothing we do, however virtuous, can be accomplished alone. Therefore, we must be saved by love. That is harder without God's guidance. That's the kind of strength and the kind of guidance that faith receives when tragedy makes us look up into the face of God. But if we look up into the face of God and hold our gaze just a little bit longer, you can see something else. If you hold your gaze just a little bit longer, you can see God weeping. Weeping over Sendai, as God has wept over countless cities, hamlets, and homes. But if you keep your gaze a little longer, you can see that God's tears are not like ours. We weep for what is lost, lives, communities, hopes, and dreams. But nothing is ever lost to God. We weep for fear of the uncontrollable, disaster, tragedy, and all that is dangerous and unforeseen. But God is neither threatened nor frightened. God weeps as a parent weeps with a child, not because of the toy or the friend or the dream, but because of love for the one who weeps. God weeps with us because God loves us and we are weeping. There is no vision of God that could be considered complete without the ability to see God weeping when we do. So as a man of faith, in a place of faith, at a time of deep and powerful pain, I ask for peace, but I ask for it on my own terms. I ask why, and I get no answer. I ask how, and I get no answer. As a fragile person in a dangerous world, I ask for protection, and it is denied me. Instead, I'm offered that which I would like to be able to live without: God's strength and God's guidance. Strength to live joyfully and hopefully in the midst of danger. Guidance to build truthfully and realistically through suffering and on a foundation of hope and faith and love. And all of this given by God who weeps with us. Is it what I wanted? It is not. Is it what I need? It is. Is there more than this? Yes. With God, there is always more. Is it enough? Yes. Sometimes barely, but it is enough. Enough to give us peace. Not peace on my terms. Not the kind that can be captured by words. Not the kind that bends to my thinking. But the kind that passes understanding and fills the heart and the mind and the soul, even while they are full of pain. Faith provides that kind of peace, and it is good. Amen.
The world has changed forever. The earth has moved. There is land where there was not land, water where there was not water. The seemingly indestructible has been shown to be fragile. When this happens, we are left shaken and unsettled. In hope, let us reflect on change.
Disaster brings tragic loss. Family and friends are no longer seen. Fortunes and homes are destroyed. Entire communities are swept away. Ordinary lives are stolen, as when a thief steals all that has been carefully saved. Even our dreams and expectations may be lost in the tides of tragedy. Let us contemplate the missing and the lost.
Death comes to all. Everything fades from this world. We mourn and lament with the grieving. With death comes ritual, for human bodies are frail, and the passing of human life calls for dignity. We give thanks and respect to all who tend the dead. After death comes the unknown, and all yearn for the divine light and peace. Let us remember the dead.
Our knowledge of the universe is incomplete. Still, we strive for comprehension. The desire for knowledge is called by many names, among them science, faith, tradition. Now, lives in peril rely on people of science for rescue, people of faith for aid, and people of tradition to reveal new. Let us embrace our role in the universe.
In the name of God, the ultimate source of unlimited compassion and unlimited mercy. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. God, in His ultimate wisdom, sends us calamities and different tests. But then the good news is those who show patience, mobilize support, relief, cooperation, commiseration, and comfort, they will have the ultimate reward from their Creator. We are a small global community today. The fate of every nation is tied to its neighbors. Although her wounds are real and profound, Japan does not stand alone in crisis. A tremor today creates shock waves on foreign shores. As a compassionate world rushes to respond, the uncertainty of this present day will pass. Let us attend the global concerns of our community together.
Another dawn is coming. The sun continues to rise, and new ways forward will be found. The cherry blossoms will come again. New paths will open. The young and the old will foster one another, and fresh hope will emerge. Together we will greet the new day, for this is the way of peace and love. Let us welcome the days to come. O gracious and merciful God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine, stir us to accomplish the tasks before us. Strengthen us for the work at hand. Abide with us in our labor. For your mercy compels our compassion, your grace inspires our justice, and your boundless love is the source of all hope. Amen.